Lakshnam Param Shastrinoho Aryamba Shiva Guru Voscha Lakshmyam Param Shastrinoho Putratvenavatirno Yo Dharma Samrakshanaya Vai Ashtamehayaneyascha Turiyamashramamagrahit Prasthanatraya Bhashyadi Lekhako Dyotakashchayaha Sringeryam Sharada Peetham Sthapayamasayo Mahan Adhyatishtachatat Peetham Lokanudhartu Mevaya Kalatyam Yojanim Lebhe Yashchata Muddhadharaha Sringeryam Sharadam Yashcha Sthapayamasa Sadguruhu Kalatyam Yojanim Lebhe Yashchatam Uddhadharaha Sringeryam Sharadam Yashcha Sthapayamasa Sadguruhu Tameva Kalati Kshetre Yavpunav Pratyatishthipat Tameva Kalati Kshetre Yavpunav Pratyatishthipat Shankara Saachidananda Shivabhinava Purvakaha Nrisimha Bharati Cheti Namadvaya Virajitam Jagadguru Maham Vande Lokanugraha Dikshitam Vande Lokanugraha Dikshitam Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnur, Gurur Devo Maheshwaraha Guru Sakshat Parambrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shuddha Sphatika Sankasham Shuddha Vidya Pradayakam Shuddham Purnam Chidanandam Sadashivam Aham Shraye Simatitam Anadyantam Namo Charana Bheshajam Kamitashesha Phaladam Shrimad Vishnu Maham Shraye Yogi Hrit Padma Nilayam Nata Jeeva Hite Ratam Shruti Naan Janma Bhoomintvam Chatur Mukhamaham Shraye Prasamahitam Atyantam Prathimamita Tejasam Vashikrita Paranandam Vasishtham Gurumashraye Shuktau Rupyamivabhati Yadrupam Maikalpitam Shaktya Parihritam Yena Shaktintam Gurumashraye Karanatita Chidrupam Paripurnam Parayanam Paramananda Santushtham Parasharamaham Shraye Vedavyasam Swatmarupam Satyasandham Parayanam Shantan Jitendriya Krodham Sasishyam Pranamamyaham त्रिकालातीतचिन्मात्रप्रशान्तस्वान्तसंयुतं विकाराद्यैरसंस्पृष्टं शुकं गुरुमहं श्रये गूढा माया यस्य वाक्यैर्व्रीडिता विलयं गता क्रीडन्तं विद्यया सार्धं गौडपादं तमाश्रये जीवेश भेदरहितं नाविकं भववारिधेः भावाभावविदूरस्थं गोविन्दं गुरुमाश्रये शङ्कारूपेण मच्चित्तं पङ्कीकृतमभूद्यया किङ्करीयस्य सा माया शङ्कराचार्यमाश्रये विश्वं मायामयत्वेन रूपितं यत्प्रबोधतः विश्वं च यत्स्वरूपन्तं वार्तिकाचार्यमाश्रये अनाद्यविद्यामुत्सार्य प्रज्ञानघनरूपतां यो बोधयति स शिष्यान् तं बोधघनमाश्रये सिताघनादिदिष्टान्तैः यत्स्वरूपं श्रुतिर्जगौ प्रज्ञानघन एवेति तन्ज्ञानघनमाश्रये ज्ञानानामुत्तमं ज्ञानं ज्ञानिनामुत्तमो यतः ज्ञानोत्तम इति ख्यातं गुरुं तमहमाश्रये ज्ञाननिःश्रेणिमालम्ब्य ब्रह्माख्यं गिरिमुन्नतम् आरुह्य कृतकृत्योयस्तं तन्ज्ञानगिरिमाश्रये दुर्वादिदुष्टमातङ्गविदारणपटीयसे नमः श्रीसिंहगिरये गुरवे दिव्यचक्षुषे ईप्सितार्थप्रदो नित्यं प्रणतानां च देहिनां यतिरीश्वरतीर्थाख्यः तन्नमामि गुरुं शिवम् श्रुतिमस्तककूटस्थम् अज्ञानद्विपभेदिनं श्रीमन्त्रराजमूर्तिन्तं नृसिंहं गुरुमाश्रये अविद्याच्छन्नभावानां नृणां विद्योपदेशतः प्रकाशयति यस्तत्त्वं तं विद्यातीर्थमाश्रये अज्ञानाञ्जाह्नवीतीर्थं विद्यातीर्थं विवेकिनां सर्वेषां सुखदन्तीर्थं भारतीतीर्थमाश्रये अविद्यारण्यकान्तारे भ्रमतां प्राणिनां सदा विद्यामार्गोपदेष्टारं विद्यारण्यगुरुं श्रये विद्या विद्या विवेकेन पारं संसारवारिधेः प्रापयत्यनिशं भक्तान् तं विद्यारण्यमाश्रये अविद्यारण्यसङ्क्लेशकृशानुभृशतापितः संश्रये सततं भूत्यै चन्द्रशेखरचन्द्रिका अविद्याख्यद्विपद्वैधीभावे दक्षं समाश्रये नृसिंहभारतीशाख्य हरिं श्रुतिगुहाश्रयम् पुरुषोत्तमतां यान्ति यमाश्रित्य जनाश्रये क्षराक्षरमतीतन्तं पुरुषोत्तमयोगिनं किङ्करीकृतभूपालं पङ्केरुहसमाननं तङ्कारुण्यपयोराशिं शङ्कराख्यं गुरुं श्रये चन्द्रिकाधवलोदारसान्द्रकीर्तिर्छटाधरम् इन्द्रियैर्दुर्जयन्नौमि चन्द्रशेखरभारतीं प्रसिद्धविद्यानिलयं लसमानगुणोत्कटम् बिसजाक्षार्चकं भक्त्या नृसिंहं तीर्थमाश्रये पुरुहूतादिदेवौघपौरुषेय गुणोत्कटं पुरुषार्थप्रदन्नौमि पुरुषोत्तमयोगिनम् कामद्विरदपञ्चास्य रामणीयकमन्दिरम् Somopamananam Srimad Ramachandra Gurum Bhaje Surasindhula Satkirtim Smarasindhu Ghatodbhavam Narasimharchakam Sriman Narasimhayatim Bhaje Sarasara Vivekagnyam Marakanana Kunjaram Shurandane cha Niratam Narasimhayatim Bhaje Nrisimhatam Prayantyashu Yamashritya Jana Bhuvi Nrisimha Bharatim Vande Dvigunopapadam Sada Tam Sarva Bhuta Bhayadam Vibhavairinvitam Param Narasimham Gurunchapi Navam Jnanar Navam Bhaje Satya Swarupam Sadjnana Nishtham Sakshachivam Param Sadadanaratam Dantam Sachidanandamashraye Mahameru Samam Dhairye Madhurye Pyamritopamam Uha Pohartha Nishnatam Narasimham Gurum Bhaje Sachitam Buja Mitraya Sacharitra Yuje Namaha Sachidananda Bharatyai Sachidananda Murtaye Sachidananda Bharatyai Navyayastu Namo Nisham Bhavyatma Jnana Nirdhuta Vidyakaryopalabdhaye Maramatanga Panchasyam Madasarpad Vijarshabham Nrisimha Bharatim Vande Jitakshaturagam Sada Tattvamasyadi Vedanta Vakyartha Jnana Varidhehe Purna Chandramasam Vande Sachidananda Yoginam Abhinava Pada Purvan Sachidananda Samnyan Nigama Shikhara Vedyan Nitya Kalyana Rupan Tribhuvana Janavandyan Sarva Lokaika Hridyan Hridaya Kamala Madhye Bhavayamya Bhujasyan Prahlada Varado Devo Yonrisimha Paro Harihi Nrisimho Pasakan Nityam Tanrisimha Gurum Bhaje Shri Sachidananda Shiva Bhinavya Nrisimha Bharatya Bhidhan Yatindran Vidyanidhin Mantra Nidhin Sadatma Nishthan Bhaje Manava Shambhurupan Sadatma Dhyana Niratam Vishayebhya Parangmukham Naumi Shastreshu Nishnatam Chandrasekhara Bharati Vivekinam Mahapragnyam Dhairyaudaryakshamanidhim Sadabhinava Purvantam Vidyatirtha Gurum Bhaje Ajnananjanavitirtham Vidyatirtham Vivekinam Sarveshan Sukhadantirtham Bharatitirthamashraye Vidyavinaya Sampannam Vitaragam Vivekinam Vande Vedanta Tattvagnyam Vidhushekhara Bharatim Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam.
Suda Kumba Viboda Mutra Vidya Virajat Karavari Jata Apara Karunya Sudam Burashim Shri Sharadam Bam Pranatos Minityam ശങ്കാരൂപേണ മർച്ചിത്തം പങ്കീകൃതമബോധ്യയാ കിങ്കരീയസ്സസാമായ ശങ്കരാചാര്യമാശ്രയേ പ്രഹ്ലാദവരദോ ദേവോ യോ നൃസംഹ പരോ ഹരിഃ നൃസിംഹോപാശകം നിത്യം തം നൃസിംഹ ഗുരും ഭജേ ശ്രീ സച്ചിദാനന്ദ ശിവാ അഭിനവ്യ നൃസിംഹ ഭാരത്യ പിതാൻ യതീന്ദ്രാൻ വിദ്യാനിതീൻമന്ത്രനിതീൻ സദാത്മനിഷ്ഠാൻ ഭജേ മാനവശംഭുരൂപാൻ സദാത്മധ്യാനനിരതം വിഷയേഭ്യ പരാൻമുഖം നൗമി ശാസ്ത്രേഷു നിഷ്ണാതം ചന്ദ്രശേഖര ഭാരതി വിവേകിനം മഹാപ്രജ്ഞം ദൗര്യോദാരക്ഷമാനിധിം സദാഭിനവപൂർവം തം വിദ്യാതീർത്ഥഗുരും ഭജേ അജ്ഞാനാം ജാഹ്നവീതീർത്ഥം വിദ്യാതീർത്ഥം വിവേകിനാം സർവേഷാം സുഖതം തീർത്ഥം ഭാരതീതീർത്ഥമാശ്രയേ വിദ്യാവിനയസമ്പന്നം വീതരാഗം വിവേകിനം വന്ദേ വേദാന്തതത്വജ്ഞം വിദുശേഖര ഭാരതി. മേ ദ ഡിവൈൻ ഗ്രേസ് ഓഫ് മഹാസന്നിധാനം ആൻഡ് സന്നിധാനം റിമൈൻ വിത്ത് അസ് ആൻഡ് മേ ദ ബെസ്റ്റ് തോട്ട്സ് വേർഡ്സ് ആൻഡ് എക്സ്പ്രഷൻസ് ഫ്ലോ ത്രൂ ദിസ് ഈവനിങ് ടു ഡു ഗുഡ് ടു ഹ്യൂമാനിറ്റി ആൻഡ് എവ്രി വൺ. വി ഹാഡ് ദ ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി to speak about Bhagavatpada Shankara in the first lecture on 22nd June and the Trinity, the 10th, 11th and the 12th Acharyal of the Mutt, the creation of the Vijayanagara Empire and how the empire took to Raja Paripalanam and how Sringeri Mutt took to Dharma Paripalanam. Prior to the advent of the Vijayanagara Empire, the saints of Sringeri, the Peethadipatis of Sringeri, were tapasvis, yogis, ex-pandits in Vedas and Mantra Shastras, but one led to the other into the Sishya Parampara for the first 300 years. The villages were created for the first time only after the Vijayanagara Samrajyam came into existence and Harihara and Bukka started to donate villages, started to add resources to the Mutt. This is exactly what we were discussing about the last two lectures. Now today and tomorrow we will essentially be knowing the life history, the contributions and the teachings of four Acharyals. The 25th Acharyal of the Mutt, Jagadguru Srimad Saachidananda Bharati Mahaswamigal. The 32nd Acharyal, Vrudha Narasimha Bharati Mahaswamigal, who is seated next to Bhagavat Padal. And the 33rd Acharyal, ജഗദ്ഗുരു ശ്രീമത് സച്ചിദാനന്ദ ശിവ അഭിനവ്യ നൃസിംഹ ഭാരതി മഹാസ്വാമികൾ. ടുഡേ ആൻഡ് ടുമോറോ വി വിൽ ഷെയർ ദ ഡിവൈൻ തോട്ട്സ് ആൻഡ് എക്സ്പീരിയൻസസ് ഓഫ് ബ്രഹ്മനിഷ്ഠർ ജീവൻ മുക്തർ ജഗദ്ഗുരു ശ്രീമത് ചന്ദ്രശേഖര ഭാരതി മഹാസ്വാമികൾ ടുമോറോ. സോ ദീസ് ഫോർ ആചാര്യാൾസ് ഇസ് വാട്ട് വി ആർ ഗോയിങ് ടു ഷെയർ ഇൻ ദീസ് ടു days. Whatever is delivered, to be delivered, is all from authentic printed texts, and all of us should be very thankful to four contributors who have made it possible, who have recorded these instances and published it as a book at different points of time to enable devotees and sishyas like us to know about them even after 100, 150 years later. For which we owe a big thanks to Shri T.K. Balasubramaniam of Vani Vilas Press, who did compile the entire works of Adi Shankara into 20 volumes. Today's speech we will conclude about saying what was that noble devotee's experience. We should also be thankful to Shrikanta Shastrihal, Bhashya Swamihal, and Jnanananda Bharati Swamihal, the Trinity again, who contributed the most precious teachings, talks, discussions, explanations of Mahaprabhu, Mahapurusha, Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal, which came in 3 volumes as Guru Kripa Vilasam. It's a delight. What we are going to possibly share is 100th or 1000th of what is available in that treasure, just to give you a taste of it. And whenever you get the occasion, all of you should actually read the original text. Why are we talking about the 25th Acharyal now, is the question. There is a unique pride to Tamil Nadu that way, because he is the only Acharyal in this whole lineage of 36 Acharyals to hail from Tamil Nadu. He hailed from a village called Kunnavaram Kotai near Vatlakundu, near my mother's village, 5 kilometers away. So when Acharyal came to Mel Mangalam, he visited Kunnavaram Kotai in 2012. Now, if you see the brief history which Jnananda Bharati Swamihal has captured, it's quite fascinating. His mother died at a very young age and his father went on a yatra and he was allowed to fend for himself. And Jnananda Bharati Swamihal writes, delightfully, Acharyal in his purvashrama took bhikshai every day from the various houses in that village, therefore confirming the fact that nobody was landless at that point of time, number one. There was Veda Paripalanam during that period and people were performing their karmas. All the three were happening and therefore Acharyal in his purvashram had no difficulty for bhikshai. He proceeded to Sringeri only to marry his uncle's daughter. That was the agenda. But when the 24th Acharyal saw him, his rupam, his tejas, his courage and his Vedic knowledge, he persuaded him to become his sishya, which the sishya actually refused. He said, I have given a promise to my uncle to marry his daughter and I want to execute that promise. Then Acharya persuaded the sishya that you need to serve humanity as you have a bigger objective and therefore you should become my sishya. He became the 25th Acharya of this Peetham. The pandits who attended the Vidvatsadas went and told the 24th Acharya, you have found one more Vidyaranya through him. When he speaks, they found it was Saraswati speaking. When he gave a clarification or an explanation to a doubt raised in the sadhas, it looked ultimate. Therefore, he once again proved the credentials of this Peetham, known for its Brahma Vidya, known for its Mantra Shastram, known for its tapas, known for its Yoga Palan. Now, he did 3 things in his tenure. One, to build a temple for Bhavani, site to Malakaneshwar. He was an expert in Shilpa Shastra. Even on those days, he ensured that Mata had a hole in the nose and 2 holes in the ears so that she can be adorned with the best of jewels without any difficulty. A statue was created in that form, and that's the Bhavani which stands even today. That is one of his contributions to the Mutt. The second contribution was building the Sikaram for the Vidyaranya temple. And the third, we read the Charitram of the 25th Acharyal more for this. There was a chieftain, a thief chieftain called Bhairava, who constantly attacked the villages of Sringeri. He spared, he ensured that he doesn't attack the Mutt and earn the wrath of the Jagadguru. So, but he went around virtually rampaging the villages. So, when he came with some 1,000 people to fight, and Sringeri village at that time had only 200 people to defend, they still won the war. And Bhairava was puzzled. Then what happened was, he went back and brought an army of 20,000 people and 700 horses for such a small village called Sringeri to ensure that he conquers it. Whenever the impossible happens, one has to depend only on the glory and the grace of God. No human effort will work there. This was proved once again by Acharyal. He just went into tapas and did constantly only japa. And what did happen? When Shankara created the Sharada Peetham and the Saraja and installed the Sharada idol, he ensured there are four Digdevatas: Durgai, Kali, Hanuman, and the Kalabhairavar. They are the four guardian deities of Sharada Ambal. When he went into tapas, Guru Vamsa Kavyam records this as a fact. All the four guardian deities waged a war against Bhairava to handle that contingent of 20,000 people. And how do you say that? The deities came back to Acharyal and showed the places where they had to receive the hurt and the injuries and displayed it to Acharyal. This is what Bhairava did it to us, but we managed to kill him. So, tapas. He ensured to get a place in history. The impossible, if need to be conquered, engage yourself in tapas. That's the short history and the most important message which the 25th Acharyal delivered to this world, as recorded by Jnananda Bharati Swamigal in his book. Now we come to the 32nd Acharyal, Vridha Narasimha Bharati Swamigal. His coming to the Peetham is again a matter of superior interest. When the 30th Acharyal wanted to actually make him the 31st Acharyal, he was born in Sringeri, and he was such a pandit in Vedas. In those days, you need to establish your panditiyam, you have to go to Kashi, debate and succeed. Then you will be an acclaimed pandit all over the country. Acharyal from Sringeri walked twice to Kashi to establish his panditiyam. Because he was in Kashi, the 30th Acharyal could not make him the 31st Acharyal. And he knew that his time has come to dispose of his mortal coil, throw it out and then reach the state of bliss. So he made Abhinava Saachidananda Bharati Swamigal as the 31st Acharyal of the Peetham. He made him today and he threw his mortal coil the next day. And remember, history records that the 31st Acharyal stayed in the Peetham exactly for 3 years as he was waiting for the 32nd Acharyal to come from Kashi. The moment Acharyal returned from Kashi, he made him the Sishya. He installed him as his next successor, and within 4 days, after 3 years of tenure in the Peetham, the 31st Acharyal departs. And the 32nd Acharyal lived for 82 long years. He got into the Peetham at the age of 21. and remained a Peethadipati for 6 decades. And what is most important to know about him is, from the age of 40, he lived only on vegetables. That was his staple food. And as years grew by, he took a few pieces of bitter gourd, paharkai. That was all he took up to the age of 82. Therefore, history records him as Paharkai Swamigal. That's how he is named. Because he lived only in Paharkai. This was his intake. He was one who conquered sleep and conquered hunger. He slept only for 3 to 4 hours a day, remaining awake for 20 to 21 hours a day. Deva-aradanai, Japam, Dhyanam, Vicharam, and sitting in bliss, Atma-anubhavam. That's what Jnananda Bharaswamigal records in his book. These were the 5 things he was doing. Now, 3 instances are quoted in the history to convey one important message for all of us. When Acharyal went to Nagpur, it is but normal for a king to receive him into his kingdom, which the king refused to do. Acharyal camped just a few miles away from the palace. And the king fell sick, realized his mistake, rushed to the Acharyal. The moment he made a request to come to the kingdom, Acharyal favored him by going to the kingdom. When he went to Rameshwaram, it was the practice at that point of time that the Koti Tirtham was always issued by a particular family. And they had it as a practice. But when Acharyal requested that, being a Peethadipati, and there is a Parampara and an Acharam that he should do it, they refused to budge. Acharyal said, Sarva Tirtham is also Koti Tirtham, and came back. The family went back and apologized. Acharyal restored the serenity of Koti Tirtham. The third instance was that which happened in Meenakshi temple, where the Archakas did not allow him to do the prayer. Right from the days of Shankara, Sringeri Peetham has a right to offer prayers in certain, it's all there in prescriptions. And one of the temples is Meenakshi temple. When he was not allowed to do the prayer for Ambal, he just placed 2 coconuts at her feet and invited her to come with him. And the Devi said, I'll come with you. And she came with Acharya. The Archakas realized, and when they apologized, he went back again and restored the pristine glory. That's why even today, if you see in the Sringeri Puja of Acharyal, which is telecast every Friday at 9 p.m., there will be a small Meenakshi idol. She is a permanent guest of Sringeri Mutt. And the first Nevedyam is offered to her because she is a guest of Sringeri. Now, what did he in the process convey? That's important. 2 things are said in our scriptures. 2 people in this world can never curse us. Cursing is an impossible task for 2 human forms. One is the form of a mother to her children. Another is the form of guru to his sishyas. Mother and guru cannot curse. It is impossible, and that's why they are worshipped. But the same scriptures also say, if you displease your mother or displease your guru, the fact that you have displeased turns into a curse. They don't curse anybody. That these 3 instances are cited only for that purpose. The message is more important than even that took place. If you do a disservice, if you abuse, if you are disloyal, and if you try to do injustice to your guru, the very conduct will transform into a curse. And therefore, that should be avoided. That's why our lineage keeps on saying, never do anything to displease your mother and your acharya. Have you not heard this? Many times our elders saying this. And this is the message. Then what happens if it transforms into a curse? That's important. That's the next important philosophical truth which all of us should understand. Mahasannidhanam, in one of his Anugraha Bhashanam, says, karmas are broadly divided into three. The prarabdha karma, which everybody has to enjoy or suffer. See, the volumes of punyam and pabam we have done, we can't exhaust it in one birth. Therefore, the karmas are classified into three. That which this present body enjoys and suffers is called prarabdha. That which this present body keeps accumulating by doing good or bad deeds in this birth becomes agami. And that which is still in store to be exhausted is called sanchita. Now these are the three karmas which travel with us from body to body. We need to believe in rebirth and we need to believe in karma. These travel. Acharyal says, one who is a realized soul, what happens on him getting realized? A jivan mukta, what happens to his karmas? Acharya explains it beautifully. Says, agami gets burnt immediately. It doesn't affect you because there is no future birth for you thereafter. So it can never mature into punya or papa. Your prarabdha, one has to exhaust in that body till the end. Take many saints, some suffering in cancer, some suffering in some bodily ailment, even though they are jivan muktas. Prarabdha has to be suffered or enjoyed. What happens to sanchita? Acharyal explains, we must understand sanchita is all the karmas done in previous birth, not in the present birth for a jivan mukta. Please, that's something Acharyal repeated it twice in the Anugraha Bhashanam. When you say that what happens, it happens, we are dealing with the past karmas in their previous births. That storehouse which has both punya and papa, it has to get exhausted. For a jivan mukta, the account should finally be zero in terms of the karma. How does it get exhausted? Mahasannidhanam says, if you serve your guru, the punyam transforms to you. And if you earn his curse, the papa transforms to you. And therefore, do not do anything which will displease your guru. And that's the central theme which we thought we can share through the avataram of the 32nd Acharya. When he was 68 years old, he decided to induct a Sishya. And who was his Sishya is interesting. Sishya was just 8 years old. There is a huge gap of 60 years between the Guru and the Sishya. Guru was 68 years old and the Sishya was 8 years old. And that Sishya is the 33rd Acharyal, Jagadguru Srimad Saachidananda Shiva Abhinavya Nrisimha Bharati Mahaswamigal, who was born in Mysore. This Acharyal is called the Abhinava Shankara. Shankara reborn again. And why do we say so? Shankara lost his father at a very early age. Acharyal lost his parents when he was just 2 or 5. 2, his mother passed away. 5, his father passed away. So he was brought up by his brother. Shankara, within 1 year, could walk, talk. Acharyal could do that in the same 1 year. Shankara became a sannyasi at the age of 8. Acharya became the 33rd Acharya of the Peetham by getting into sannyasam at the age of 8. Acharyal Shankara was born in Kalati. Acharyal rediscovered the birthplace of Shankara and performed the Kumbhabhishekam in 1910. Shankara was a great poet. Acharya's poems are in 3 volumes as Bhakti Sudha Tarangini, the same format in which Shankara has done with various deities. So, every aspect, he was a Shankara. How did he come into the Peetham? When he was less than 8 years old, when the 32nd Acharyal went to Mysore and the Sishya met the Acharyal, he asked him, "What do you want?" At the age of 8, the Sishya sang the glory of Shiva by reciting the Shiva Bhujangam. Then Acharyal thought, he has found his Sishya, and inducted him as the next Peethadipati. When he was 8 years old, he did not reach Sringeri. Between 8th year and the 20th year, they were in a Vijayatri for 12 long years. That night, on his Sanyasra Ashramam day, when young boy of 8 year old slept, he started chanting in dream, "Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham," which pleased the senior Acharyal that the Peethadipati has finally arrived for the Mutt. After 12 long years of journey, when they reached Sringeri, it is the Parampariyam to invite the Acharyals in the golden palanquin and the silver palanquin. Gold palanquin for the senior Acharyal and the silver palanquin for the junior Acharyal. For a minute, after all, at the age of 20, for a minute, the Acharyal looked at the golden palanquin. And the senior Acharyal said, "You are looking at this? If you have to be seated here, you must know what should be your tapopalan." Asked, Nella kondu varasonar, dropped it into the palanquin. Odane adu puriya purinjadu. Immediately became puri. "If you have this tapopalan, then you are entitled to sit in this golden palanquin." This happened when the Shishya was 20 years old and the senior Acharyal was 80 years old. And at the age of 82, the senior Acharyal departed. Just before his departure, when the senior Acharyal was in complete trance, Shishya goes to him, prostrates, and touches his holy feet. Then Vrdha Narasimha Bharati Mahaswamigal says to his Shishya, "Please don't touch me." Then the Shishya asks, "Why and why not?" He says, "I am not able to bear your heat, and I see the tapopalan in 2 years' time." That test which was set for him, he passed it in less than 2 years. The lineage, historically recorded events, keep proving this fact that tapopalan is what which drives the Peetham for 1200 years, nothing else. So this happened, and therefore the senior Acharyal decided, "It's time for me to depart," and decided to depart. How he departed, I will say in the end, because I want to spend 5 or 10 minutes about how Vidyaranya Maharaj, how Vrdha Narasimha Bharati Swamigal, and how Saachidananda Bharati Swamigal departed from this world. That itself is a historical, a matter of historical importance and spiritual pristinity. So I would like to share that separately. So he departed. Now Acharyal took over the Peetham. and. Three instances need to be narrated, considering that we need to travel a lot about other things, because today I want to spend some time about what did the 33rd Acharyal preach to very, very ordinary mortals like that, like us. He has given a syllabus so simple, so structured, so elementary that every step is easy to practice, one step after the other, one step the other, and he gives you a schedule of how we can transform into a better individual. I would like to concentrate on that, and therefore let me narrate few instances here and there and get into that thought. That's important. In the life history of both the 32nd Acharyal and the 33rd Acharyal, let me highlight also the importance of Chandramoulishwara. Last time we spoke about Sharadambal. Let us understand what happened in their lifetime with the devotees through Chandramoulishwara, which is the Vigraham Adi Shankara handed over to Sureshwara. Two properties, two tangible properties, Ratnagarbha Ganapati, the ruby stone Ganapati, and the Spatika Linga Chandramoulishwara. And the Peetam believes, if at all the Peethadipati has anything to do with tangible properties, these are the only two asserts which they need to protect and preserve, because it is handed over by Adi Shankara. They don't care about anything else. And why I am saying this is an incident that took place for Chandramoulishwara needs to be explained. In the life history of the 32nd Acharyal, when he was traveling in his palanquin, after sunset, they just parked themselves nearby riverbed, do their evening oblations, perform the Chandramoulishwara puja, and then carry on their journey the next day. We're talking about 16th century, 500 years back. So on one fine day, one evening, Acharyal camped in a place. Thick forest and a brook running nearby. Finished his snanam and he was getting ready for the Chandramoulishwara puja. Then a group of thieves visited that place. They were kind enough to allow the Acharyal to perform the puja. They didn't disturb the puja. They waited. The puja was performed. Then Acharyal was doing the alankaram, offering the archanai through gold leaves of bilva, adorned it with a necklace, and finally took the Deva-aradanai. After this got over, the thieves then declared their purpose and intention and said that we have come here to carry all the jewels and the properties of, please hand it over to us. Then Acharyal said, these are not my property, in which case I would have parted it with you. These are all properties of Chandramoulishwara, so please don't touch it. And the thieves explained, no, we can't do that because this is our avocation. We have families to run. In fact, the dialogue is put neatly, nicely discussed, how they talk with each other. So they say, no, you must understand, we are all family men, and this is our thuril, this is our occupation. Stealing is our occupation. So we have come to steal because you have enough resources to give it to us. Either you give it to us or we will take it from you by force. Then Acharyal said, all right. You then spread your blanket, whatever you have brought to collect it, you collect it. So they spread the blanket in the night, dark night. And Acharyal started putting all the jewels one after the other. So the guys finally bundled it all from all the four sides. And when they tried to lift it, they couldn't lift it. Nrisimha Bharati Mahaswamigal writes it beautifully. And even Narayana Sami Mama in his Sringeri Shankara explains it even more elaborately. So they lift it, they are not able to lift it. Then the thieves call a few more. They lift it, they are all mere jewels. You can't carry jewels of 100 kilos at any point of time in any human life cycle. They couldn't lift. And when they desperately tried, the blanket gave away and the jewels fell down. And they realized that they are playing with fire. But Acharyal, for his compassion, said, even for you, Lord Shiva is your ruling deity because he is worshipped as Taskarana, the Lord of Thieves. So pay your obeisance. Those thieves stayed that night, ensured that he finishes his morning prayers, carried all the, because those days you carry all your travel kit only in elephants and horses from one place to another. They came up to the next village and then went back to their own place. So this is one incident of Chandramouleshwara, which happened in the life of the 32nd Acharya. Now coming to the 33rd Acharya, it's even more alarming. When Acharyal was camping in a place called Belaguppe, it was a small village. And even today, when you see Acharyals camping in small villages in places like Tirunelveli, one Agraharam, he will be in one house, the entourage will be in the other house, then the puja, it'll be so nice to see it. Very simple, very, very formatted, and so pleasant. So 400 years, 500 years back, you can, I mean, 250 years back, you could imagine what would have happened. So he was camping in a village. Next day morning, suddenly they come and say, Ratnagarbha Ganapati and Chandramouleshwara is stolen. It's not there. On hearing this, Jagadguru Srimad Saachidananda Bharati I, 33rd Acharya, went, took a snanam, and in wet sannyasa vastram, sat into meditation and meditated on Lord Narasimha. Went on till 7 o'clock in the evening, go out, take the bath, come back with the wet vastram, sit again, overnight prayer. Next day morning, get up, go on bed, come back and resume the prayer. Nobody ate for 3 days, that's what it says. For 3.5 days, nobody did anything. Everything was standstill and Acharyal was meditating. After 3.5 days, an inspector comes and says, let me take your blessings and hunt for the treasure. And he was the first who picked up the courage to speak to Acharya. Why don't you eat something? And Acharya replies, I am not in that state. What is the purpose of meditating on Lord Narasimha? That was the next question. Acharya explains, when Shankara confronted a Bhairava, he wanted his head. He wanted the head of either a king or a sannyasi. Getting the head of a king is not easy. So he said, give me the head. And Shankara said, yeah, please take my head, I have no problem. But come when my disciples are not around me. Otherwise they will not allow you to do. And what did Shankara do? He went into meditation, meditating on Narasimha. And Padmapada, Narasimha, history records, Shankara Digvijayam says, Narasimha came out of Padmapada because Padmapada was himself a Narasimha Upasakar and tore the Bhairava into pieces. Now, Acharyal explains to the inspector, when giving one's life is the ultimate, and Shankara was ready to do that. I am now in the same position. To us, if somebody is going to say Ratnagarbha Ganapati and Chandramouleshwara are not with you, then it is as good as not living in existence. Because we are not different from that. And these are the only two treasures Shankara has handed over to us. And we need to therefore preserve. I am in that state. And therefore, just doing what Shankara did. And continued his prayer of Narasimha. After 5.5 days, after 2 days from this inspector, comes back and says, I have found something in the nearby field. Can some of you come and identify whether it's that Vigraham? the palanquin is sent. Scorching sun in the midday. As the palanquin reached the field, and Ratnagarbha Ganapati and Chandramolisra were placed into the palanquin, there was a downpour rain. History records it that way. Till it came back to Acharyal. On seeing Ratnagarbha Ganapati and Chandramolisra, history records Acharyal embraced the inspector. What he Rama did to Hanuman, he did to inspector. That's how Dhyananda Bharati Swamigal compares it. So this was the second incident about Chandramolisra. And the third incident happened again in the life history of the 33rd Acharyal. A poor Vedic pandit wanted to get his daughter married. And he came and prostrated before Acharyal, but did not show due reverence to Chandramolisra. So Acharyal said, you have given a patrikai, you go and meet the administration. And there is a procedure, follow that procedure. So he went and met somebody, and there is a standard format, and something was given to him which looked insufficient for him. So he waited the whole night. Early morning, 3:30, when Acharyal rises up to have his morning oblations, he falls at his feet suddenly. And Acharyal says, you have still not gone back. No, I can't go back because the marriage is fixed next week and I need resources. Then Acharyal said, waited for a minute. He calculated, from today to Thursday, on Thursday I will be in a bigger village. More number of devotees will come. You come and see me on that day. So, this Sishya, the devotee, goes on a Thursday to that village, which is a large village. Waits before the Acharya. Every devotee who started to contribute, there is always a plate, whoever wants to offer their kanike, they do it. Even today that's the practice. So when they started offering the kanike, Acharya did not allow the plates to be carried in. He said, keep the plates there. And a few of them started to offer silver coins. Said, everything place it there. When the morning darshan was about to get completed, he called that Sishya and said, take all this today and perform your daughter's marriage. You disrespected Chandramolisra last time and see what he has done to you this time. We are not different from Chandramolisra. So these are the instances which we thought we can narrate about in the history of Acharya. No, tapopalam. It is said in history that a Jivan Mukta, how do you identify somebody as a Jivan Mukta? One who is an emancipated soul. One, they will be absolutely fearless. Why? Because fear is something associated to the body. And one who is detached from this body can never have fear. Two, ahimsa. Because there is no second person for him to hurt. And third is tolerance. Whatever may happen around them, they will be completely indifferent. Is what a Jivan Mukta Lakshanangal. And all these three stood proved in the life history of the 33rd Acharya. As he was performing the Chandramolisra Puja, which happens in the night every day, his history records, one fine day there were two interesting visitors to the puja, two tigers. They came there, sat through the whole puja and peacefully left the place. So fearlessness, absolutely he was indifferent to the surroundings. It's what it says. Ahimsa. When a snake, because it's all Sringeri is a forest, a snake was crawling and it got in, it as he sat in his peetam, it got into it. And the people did not know what to do because it is snake. when he was made, when he realized that it was under it, he just simply lifted his palakai and allowed the snake to move smoothly without even the least hurt. And when it comes to tolerance, he was a Brahma Vidya Upasaka. And he, in fact, the 32nd Acharyal has said, one day you will reach the status of Sadashiva Brahmendral. That will be the glorious standing you will have in your lifetime. So, he had a passion to Sadashiva Brahmendra's Atma Vidya Vilasam. He will ask somebody to read it and he will go into trance. When he went into trance, a wild fly started to pierce his thigh absolutely from top to bottom, profusely bleeding, and he was in complete bliss, is what is being recorded. So, it is this, an Acharyal of these qualities was holding the Peetham as the 33rd pontiff of the Mutt, is what history records. Now, what did he teach in his lifetime to us? He takes it step by step. The first thing he wants us to know is, you have two options. See, I'm putting this in a way that a modern mind can understand. The language in which it has been written is slightly modified to ensure that we understand it with our modern terms. That's one amendment I have made. I should clarify that. And in the process, if I have missed out or have suggested something of what he has said, if it is slightly different, the mistake is mine and not that of Acharyal. These are two limitations or caveats I put it even before I speak. Because we are going to talk about something which he has spoke from his frame of mind. Now he says, once you are born as a human being, you have an option either to consider your body alone as existence, as truth, or something beyond the body. If you're going to say, I love to sleep, I love to eat, I love to roam, things are all happening nicely for me, why should I even bother about anything else beyond this? Then be it so. Then your journey starts and ends with this human body as truth. But if you feel that there is something beyond this, how do you first understand there is something beyond this body? We have to believe it. So he puts a simple test. He says, you ask these following questions to yourself. When somebody asks you, who are you able to say, I am hand, I am head, I am a leg, I am a heart, I am a chest? Can you address by identifying yourself as the parts of the body? If somebody inquires about your health, he says, my body is not okay. So Acharya asks the question, you are saying my body, who is this my? Then he puts it into every other form. You breathe. Can somebody be identified, I am a breath, I am breath? You can't say so. You say, my breath is not, the doctor says, I am not breathing properly. Now he says, then take it to your mind, my mind. Take it to your buddhi, my buddhi. Take it to your ego, my ego. So, who is this my? Have you ever thought about it? So when you say my body, there must be a owner to this body. There must be a owner to this breath. There must be a owner to this mind, owner to this buddhi, and owner to this ahankara. Have you tried to know who this owner is? And gives how you can find this out. which is the example given in philosophy, which everyone uses it to drive home the same truth. When we are in a waking state, and when we lie down, we get into the dream state, and once we get into a deep sleep state, none of our body resources function to our knowledge. Because pragnya pa kadayadu. Next day morning we get up and convey to somebody, I had a wonderful sleep. Your body is not active. Your mind is not active. Your buddhi is not active. Your ego is not active. Because it's all sleeping. So Acharyal says, who is instructing you to say that I had a good sleep? And now, say, Acharyal says, you have to trust this companion or this owner is called in philosophy as the Jivatma, who is different from the body, different from the mind. Otherwise, you have to identify the Jiva as body, Jiva as mind, which you are not able to. When I ask that question, you are not able to answer it. So it is something independent. Are you able to believe this fact and says, as a human being, this human, how is human being rare and different from the rest? It is rare and different only because we have the sense of reasoning. So, can you trigger that sense of reasoning to understand that there is a jiva within you? And now, classifies the human forms into four. First, one who understands everything starts and ends with the body. It's the first category. He sleeps well, he eats well, he enjoys life, which animals also do. That's first category. Fourth category, somebody who disowns the body and lives only in his Atma. He is a Jivan Mukta, who is the fourth last stage. He doesn't need anything in this world. And says, most of us otherwise belong to the second and the third category. Where we believe there is a Jiva and we also believe that body is truth. That's the state in which we are all placed. Between 2 and 3, the second category believes more in body and less in Jiva. And the third category believes more in Jiva and less in body. It's a progression. Now Acharyal says, it is enough if you are there in the second or the third. It doesn't matter. That's enough. That's good enough. Are you able to believe in the existence of this duality at the moment? Can you believe? And now cites Shankara. The whole philosophy Advaita of Shankara is put in 1.5 sentences. Brahman is Satyam, this material world is Mithya, and there is no difference between Jivatma and the Paramatma. This is all Shankara says. And therefore, Jiva resides within you. Believe this. If you are able to progress up to this stage, now he takes the second course. Course 2. Then he puts two questions to us. Who are your friends? Don't say so-and-so. He's not asking that. Who are your friends to your mind and to your intellect? And gives an answer. If you're going to say, my closest friends are desire and anger, then this will lead you in a particular path. In the alternative, if you say that, yes, desire and anger is something which, in fact, he writes one chapter beautifully on anger. I think any management scientist will like to know about how can you conquer anger. He puts it in three formats while explaining it to a very senior police officer who says, I don't know, my job requires, demands me to do that, but it has now become my second nature. As a human being, I'm not able to take it. How do I transform? And he educates him how he can transform, how he can get rid of anger. It's a beautiful chapter in that book. So, the second course he takes you hours. Who are your friends? See, everything is something which you need to spend some time to think. If you're going to say, if you have identified desire and anger to be your friends, then he says, it will lead you to acquire four more enemies, all put together six. Kama, Krodha, Moha, delusion. Kama, Krodha, Moha, Loba, greed, Mada, arrogance, and Matsalya, jealousy. So, if these are your friends in life, they take you there. You have one more option. I'm putting it in a slightly modern style, please bear, because the way Acharyal puts it is beautiful. I'm trying to put it in a blunt, understandable, communicable mode. Now, you have a second option. Can you think of two new friends? One is Vedas, faith in Vedas, and the other is surrender to a guru. If Vedas and guru become your friends, they lead you to acquire six virtues instead of six enemies. It's a choice. It's a choice. If greed, if anger and desire are your friends, it takes you in one direction. If faith in Vedas and surrender to Guru is your friend, when it comes to Guru, friendship with the Guru is an exalted state. I would not like to say it that way. Yeah, surrender to Guru. That's how we should at this stage say. Now it again leads you to six virtues: Sama, Tama, Titiksha, Uparati, Shraddha and Samadhi. Sense control, mind control, resistance, tolerance, calmness and bliss. So, choice is given to you to choose between these two pairs. Second course. Now third, if we opt for Vedas, why should we opt for Vedas? Why should we have faith in Vedas? He says in his lectures, you can find anything that is being practiced in this world undergoing some change. Anything that is produced undergoing adaptation. Ramayana, you have multiple versions of Ramayana. Mahabharata, you have multiple versions of Mahabharata. But Vedas are the only feature. How it was chanted billions of years back, it is chanted even today in the same format. And it shall be chanted even billion years later in the same format. It will not undergo change. The chanting won't undergo a change. The content won't undergo a change. And the meaning won't undergo a change. Nothing will undergo a change. It's static dynamism. It shall remain there without a change. Why? Because it is not created or ordered by a human boy. That's exactly what Acharya puts it. When Brahma emerged out of the mouth of Mahavishnu to create this world, he came out with Vedas to use that as a format to create this world. Vedas came with him to facilitate us a proper living. Vedas facilitate us to live. You can't reduce it to any other status of it. That's why we say faith in Veda, whether it is written form, who is the author. See, rationalists will ask any question. What is their problem? If they are ready for a logical argument, we can persuade them. They are not ready. They will only ask questions. Show me the other. That is because they will not go for invisible pramanam. They will go only for either I should experience or I should see. I won't see any other pramanam. How do you then go and debate with such people? It's better to give it up. Okay, fine. You be where you are. Let's not worry about them. We are not here to transform. If they are destined to transform, they will get transformed. That's not our job. We should see whether we are ready to get transformed. That's our goal in life. So, a bhakti to Vedas, can you think of? It's one friend in our life. What we call it, the Sanatana Dharma, the way of life. And the second is the surrender to a guru. Now, Acharyal puts it so beautifully. When will a guru emerge in one's life? That's the point. All will be interested to know, when will my guru come? I want to see a guru. And says, two, three things, one after the other in sequence. The emergence of a guru in somebody's life precedes enormous prayers in several births. One who has done so much of prayers, pleasing God. God rewards that human soul by showing a guru to him. That's how Acharya puts it. Guru emerges in the scene only then. See, we can take people, any number of people, they'll all come. But they will feel, oh, it's very nice, the place is very good, it's very serene. Like one more tourist spot. And oh, it's very, like a temple, it's very holy, they'll do all that and go back. You can't expect everybody to enjoy the same experience. The journey is always alone, always simple, always very secret. It's between you and your guru, nobody else. So, the second stage, first is serving God, leads you to a guru. And one guru comes into your life, it is this guru who will initiate you by telling you, you have a jiva and you are a jiva which is not different from the Paramatma. So it's a necklace. Acharya says, now Shankara says there is no difference between jivatma and Paramatma. That's the second sentence, half sentence. Brahmam is satyam, this world is mithya, and there is no difference between jivatma and Paramatma. And who is there to teach us that there is no difference? Acharya says, the emergence of a guru in your life. Once guru comes into our life, we should believe and we should worship him in that form. He says that in his lecture. Says, once guru emerges in your life, there is no difference, absolutely no difference between God, Guru, and Jiva. Oh, this deity is superior to our Guru. Whether our Guru is superior to that deity, all compare. We are attached so much to forms. We are attached so much to comparables. It's not so easy. But says, these are the benefits you will get if you associate with a Guru. Where can a guru? It is so structured. You must read those lectures. Jagadguru Bharati Swamigal has captured it so beautifully. So, if you take this path, then you go there. And tells, this is something which is of vital importance to the present day happenings. Now he takes you to the third stage. So, we understood the first stage about body and jiva. The second stage, who are your friends? Desire or anger or Vedas are? Not friend, surrender to Guru. Then if you opt for the Vedic path, then he says, it as a phenomena shows you four doors, four ways. Four, which Bhagavad Gita explains it in a very, very structured way. The Jnana Yoga, the Dhyana Yoga, the Karma Marga, and the Bhakti Marga. And says, why we should opt to Bhakti? That's the most important point. All of us today spend so much time listening to Vedantic lectures. So all of us do that. You see the WhatsApp, every third WhatsApp message derives you some philosophical truth. Every channel you turn about, Bhakti channel you turn about, people are giving lectures on Vedanta. So, this Jnana and after that Dhyana, Dhyana with Yoga, both are extremely nice marketable features to a modern mind. Why? Because intellectual, if you trigger the intellect, then you find a following. But let me understand, we are not condemning any school, we are not condemning anybody. Mutt doesn't believe in it and we also don't believe in it. So it's not trying to, but you must understand in the whole feature, it has a place, and when do you reach there? You can't be doing PhD while doing fourth class, nor do fourth class when you are entitled to do two PhD. You can't be doing swapping your standards of education in life. So he puts all these four to you in a basket and says, choice is not with you. We are now choosing. Jnana, Dhyana, we all say that. In fact, yoga at least has physical discipline compared to this Vedanta, hearing Vedanta lectures only for the ears, like a music concert, like watching a film. You 2 hours or 45 minutes, some good lecture, it's very nice. Because next moment, transformation doesn't happen by listening. He says, I want to put you into a path of transformation. You have to change. If you have to change, listening to Vedanta won't change. Vichara and Vedanta will change. But to do Vichara, mind cannot be volatile. And for the mind not to be volatile, by listening to Vedanta, it will not become solid. That's the point. So, constantly listening to Vedantic lectures alone will not transform. It's good. Anything is good. We are nobody, as I said, nobody, I am too small in the system to belittle anything, and I won't do it. Make it clear. But this is what understanding, how do we understand it? Same thing happens with yoga. Because before Adi Shankara integrated yoga, which we saw that in our previous lectures, a mere yoga ultimately leads to Nirishwaram. Because dry abstract yoga ultimately doesn't believe in God. Therefore, Shankara integrated it as part and capped it by saying, this leads you to that truth. Nirishwaravadam. So, unless you have faith, bhakti and belief in God, getting into dhyana is abstract. Now you are left with a balance too. Karma and bhakti. And all of us, it's so common for us to say, oh, we are all doing our duty. So casually we say, we are doing what Krishna has said. All, you know, exchange of mails, WhatsApp mails, we'll say all this. You're very busy. Yes, yes, morning till evening, I'm doing my duty. Nothing of that. What is me? What do you mean? Acharyal asked three questions. Very interesting, very, very pungent. He says, karma is a centerpiece. You can do a karma in two ways. Same. Somebody is a dancer, somebody is a doctor, somebody is a lawyer. You can be in the thick. Krishna says, I love people who are action oriented, but actions directed towards me, not merely action oriented people. It is better because human thought and mind cannot be without actions. So, when he puts that, he asks only one question. How are you performing your karma? There are two ways of performing a karma. You do a job and attach your ego to the job. You will say, I'm passionate, I'm sincere, I'm honest, I'm hardworking, everything tick. But I do it with my ego also into it. Acharyal says, that karma leads to bandha. It will bind you, it will trap you. Even though you are sincere, honest, dedicated, everything. The same karma, if you do it as a service, as a duty, without looking for the rewards, then the karma becomes yoga. For which you must have faith. You must have faith in something other than your ego. Not your ego, because ego binds you. Therefore says, you can't say, I will do karma and I'll get myself emancipated. So after knocking off all these three options, he first eliminates. He is doing what a modern mind, see. He addresses a modern mind. He doesn't thrust bhakti. He says, you take this, I'll travel your way. You take the first three and say whether it will lead you to God. It won't lead you to God because you are not matured. So what is left out for you is only bhakti. And that is why a traditional mutt speaks repeatedly about anushtanam, repeatedly about vigraha aradhane, repeatedly about going to holy shrines. If traditional mutts also give this up, then world will be only filled with Vedantic lectures and yogic dimensions, PowerPoint presentations, which will not do any transformation in us unless you clean yourself. That's the words, the expression used in the lecture is, in the lecture note is, acharam anushtanam leading to chitta shuddhi. Bhakti can give you that. All the other schools can also give you that. But are you mature to do that? This is easier. This is comfortable. And this is part of your routine. This is part of your lineage. And therefore, says, Vigraha Upasanai is must. You must do puja. You must do the prescribed karmas. So once you believe in Vedas, we will believe in karmas, the prescriptions. Once we believe in those prescriptions, Acharyal says, you will do two things. Acharam and Anushtanam. Acharam for the body. Acharam is the type of life which one has to lead. Using the body. Anushtanam is for the mind, the disciplining the mind. So go by the Vedic prescription, do these two. Then it leads you to chitta shuddhi. A volatile mind becomes a strong and a steady mind. That's exactly what it, very words used in the lecture note. A mind which is scrabbling here and there, you are able to consolidate that mind only when you do this upasana. You listen to any lecture, they will all be asking, hey, he's speaking very, all after seeing 150, you he's speaking the same thing, yaar. In fact, Acharya addresses in one of his Anugraha Bhashanam, I will continue to speak the same thing because unless you transform, I am not going to stop speaking. I am speaking the same thing. How many of you transformed? In spite of speaking the same thing several times to you, it takes so much time. And I'll still be patient to speak the same thing to you to ensure that at least you transform. And he's speaking simple things. Can we sit in the Vidvat Sadas with him to understand what he's speaking? And question is Vedic knowledge on Brahma Sutra. Are we competent? So, unless we start in a simple form, in simple way, somewhere we have to begin. And therefore, he puts this as a very important requirement, bhakti. And how to do bhakti? Bhakti with the Vedic prescriptions, with vigraha upasana. If you do these, then it will gradually take you wherever you are destined to go. And says, as one of the indispensable requirements, you must be constantly within the radius of your Guru. By visiting him, if you have his padukas, by worshipping his padukas, because there is no difference between Acharyal and Acharyal Padukai. If you have any of his belongings, then he says, I am there. In fact, Chandrasekhar, tomorrow I will say that. Chandrasekhar Swami says, how to do a upasana with Padukai. He has given a lecture. He has given a lecture on that. How do you imagine when you do offer a prayer to Padukas? He has said that. So, being associated with a Guru, and he says, why should you be in constant contact with a Guru? It is one-on-one. He will assess, a Guru can assess anybody's strength anywhere. Guru as a tattvam is beyond the body. That's different. We'll come to that little later. But a Guru Sishya Bandham, you cannot learn it through internet. By reading, don't think we can transform. By listening, don't think we can transform. Unless the Guru wills it, you cannot transform. So a Sishya puts a question. All this is understandable. ரொம்ப நல்லா புரியுறது. ஆனால் பண்ண முடியலையே. தட்ஸ் த பேசிக் க்வெஸ்சன். அண்ட் ஹி கிவ்ஸ் அன் ஆன்சர். ஐ ஆம் நாட் ஏபிள் டு டூ. ஐ வாண்ட் டு டூ, ஐ எம் நாட் ஏபிள் டு டூ. ஸோ வாட் டூ ஐ டூ? ஹி கிவ்ஸ் அன் ஆன்சர் ஃபார் ஈவன் டு தட் க்வெஸ்சன். சீ ஹிஸ் கம்பேஷன். ஹீ சேஸ், டோன்ட் வரி, ஐ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட். And the philosophical reason which he gives is different. Your vasanas, our purva janma punya papas, how it will be an impact, that's why do good. That's a different line. We'll come to it whenever we get an opportunity to speak about it, how it happens. But now for today's understanding, he says, I'm not able to do, so what do I do? He says, just do four things to me. Just four. One is faith. Faith in Vedas. And faith in a Guru. Two, nobody can attempt anything perfectly. Perfection doesn't come in one stroke. So, you make an attempt. Have you made an attempt? He says, tick box. All computer form. You can log in and tick box and answer these questions. Have you made an attempt? You will fail. Definitely you will fail. Third stage, feel that you have failed. That's very important. We don't do that. He says, feel. I'm supposed to do this in this as a human being. I'm supposed to do this because I have taken this human form, but I'm unable to do it. Oh my Guru, feel, he says. Spend your time on feeling. If you're not able to do, spend your time on feeling. Then, if you feel sincerely, in fact, there is an incidence in the life history of Vidyaranya. How we have defended Hinduism. Nobody can do anything. Let them do whatever they want to do. It will always go in cycles. A person who believes in Sanatana Dharma should never get agitated. He should see what is happening in the world. But he should see that nothing is lost. Because Adharma will try to consume Dharma. When he is about to consume, there will be avatara and destroy that Adharma. And Adharma will again come up. Then there will be a chase. So this is how it keeps on repeating. So if more and more Adharma is growing, there is one way of interpreting it. Okay, it's choking and therefore we can wait for the avatara. Whether in our lifetime or after a few centuries, we don't know. You can't, that's why Acharya will say, don't fight against the current. ஈஸ்வரனுக்கு தெரியும்பா உலகத்தை எப்படி பார்த்துக்கிறதுன்னு. இதை பண்ணணுமே, அதை பண்ணணுமே, ரொம்ப லாட் ஆஃப் என்தூசியாசம் வில் தேல் கோ அண்ட் சே. ஈஸ்வரனுக்கு தெரியும்பா, நீங்கள் முதல்ல மாறுறதுக்கு வழி பண்ணிக்கோங்க. நீங்கள் என்ன பண்ணணுமோ அதை, ஆர் யூ சேஞ்சிங், ஆர் யூ ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபார்மிங், தட்ஸ் த ஃபஸ்ட் க்வெஸ்சன். நீங்கள் ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபார்ம் பண்ணுங்கப்பா, அப்புறம் சொசைட்டியெல்லாம் அப்புறம் ட்ரான்ஸ்ஃபார்ம் பண்ணலாம். நல்ல காரியம் தான், அதெல்லாம் பண்ணலாம். பட் ஆர் யூ டூயிங், தட்ஸ் த ஃபஸ்ட் ப்ரைமரி க்வெஸ்சன் வில் ஆஸ்க். ஏன்னா ஈஸ்வரனுக்கு தெரியும், தட்ஸ் த கன்விக்ஷன். ஜீவன் முக்தோ ஆர வேதாந்தி வில் சே. But we should, as human beings, what little best we can do, what little reach. That's not the idea. That's not what he is also saying. So, we were in feeling. Now, in Vidyaranya Maharaj's case, when he was traveling into, before reaching Vijayanagara Empire, there was invasion before the establishment of the Vijayanagara. He's coming to Vijayanagara, Hampi, for the first time. Finds the conquest, the plunder, the damage. Literal, one example. In a remote village in Andhra, he goes one afternoon. And he bathes. And in the last lecture, I have said about Singhi, the invisible gift of Vyasa, who will accompany him. He will be visible only to the eyes of Vidyaranya. And he will do whatever help Vidyaranya demands. Nobody else can see. And finally, he was built a temple where he was placed inside the Virupaksha temple. He was given the relief by doing offering enough of curd rices every day. And our belief is the Malayala Brahma statue, the guardian deity in Sringeri, is a representation of that only. That's the faith. That's how Narayan Sami Mama writes it in Sringeri Il Shankara. So now that Shingi, now Vidyaranya Maharaj says, okay, this is afternoon, oblation is over. Go and find out into the Agraharam whether there is somebody to offer us bhikshai. So Shingi goes into the Agraharam and he finds the whole Agraharam in tatters. Nobody is there except for one person whose clothes are all torn, who is completely hurt, damaged, including his Upanayanam cut. And he is shouting with pain, Mahadeva, Mahadeva, Mahadeva. That's the Japam he is doing. So Shingi comes and reports to Vidyaranya Maharaj that this is the type of person now in this village. I think you cannot have bhikshai today. Then Vidyaranya says, please bring that man. So Shingi lifts him and brings him to the river. And he inquires what happened. And the man narrates the history. I have two sons and two are married. They are all Veda Panditas. Because of the conquest and invasion, the kind of damage they did it to me, I told them, please spare my children. Whatever you want to inflict, inflict it on me. Leave my children. So I allowed them to go back to different places so that they perpetuate the Vedic practices into the next generation. I am in a dying age. I said, I am ready for whatever you want, for your onslaught. And the kind of cruelty that is meted out to him, he narrates it beautifully. It's all recorded. The kind of cruelty, I just can't divulge it over a mic in a public forum. That's the kind of cruelty he has undergone. And he says to Vidyaranya, why I am saying this, the connect is this. He says to Saint Vidyaranya, I have not done my Nitya Karmas for a few days. And it is so painful that I have stopped it. I am helpless. I am not able to even get up or lift myself. And how should I do it? Vidyaranya Maharaj tells him, when you are helpless, when you are in a helpless situation, if you feel what you are supposed to do, you have not done, it is equivalent to doing that karma. He gives that answer. Feel that you have not done it. Feel that you ought to have done it and you are in a helpless. It's not feeling guilty. Helpless, feeling guilty has an element of laziness in it, has an element of arrogance to it. It's not feeling guilty, feeling sincerely that you have left it out. That's something which I need to do, I have not done it. He says, it's equivalent to doing. And he offers a mantra upadesam. He chants it for the first time loudly, second time mildly, third time Acharyal is not able to hear and he passes. This is the power of karmas, the kind of penance. So Acharyal says, have faith, do a sincere attempt, and if you still fail, feel, keep feeling. If you do that, your guru will help you then and convert that feeling into a craving. He will give that mind that strength, the body that strength, to make you do what you are supposed to do. So I'm not able to do, it's all right. Go and cry. Feel. Then the transformation will take place. And if you're going to, and Acharyal says in the Sudharma, in one of the speeches, in fact I said this on the last occasion, people don't even do that, they all come and ask me, Swamiji, is there an easy way? Thakku engalukku jeevan muktharaganum, edha shortcut iruka? Shortcut. Abdiye, then we should become. Is there any way? No way. There's no way. So, this is the climax, a clue, an assurance given to every devotee who believes in Vedas and who believes in Guru. You cannot lose. That's the confidence he gives. Only provided you are ready to feel. And from this, therefore, let's believe, because it is Acharya's words, bhakti, vigraharadhanai, upasanai, and doing the karmas are indispensable, and you can start it at any time. Don't say, I have become 80, I have become 70, because this is one body. We have had millions of bodies earlier, and we don't know how many more journeys we are going to crawl upon, travel into. We don't know. So nothing is a waste. You can start at any stage, at any point of time. Earlier the better. So this is the wholesome process of his teaching. I'll wind up with two more things. I wanted to say something about T.K. Balasubramaniam. Because when we speak about the 32nd Acharyal, the 33rd Acharyal and 34th Acharyal, we should refer to him because his contribution to the mutt is invaluable. T.K. Balasubramaniam started the Vani Vilas Press. And when Saachidananda Bharatigal, in his lifetime, the 33rd Acharyal created a Veda Patashala in Sringeri, 1895. Created a Shastra Patashala in Bangalore, 1911. Did the Kalidi Kumbhabhishekam, he rediscovered, for what, in fact, that chapter of his, how he rediscovered Kalidi, it's an interesting chapter. It's a very, very important milestone in the history of the Sringeri Peetham, because the place was lost. And he rediscovered it, and a widow lady came into his dream and said, you come and see me here. Acharya goes and sees and identifies that as the place where Shankara's mother Aryamba gets cremated. Even today we worship in that place. There is a light glowing, lamp glowing. And the way that Kumbhabhishekam was pursued, 600 temporary sheds in 1910. And there is a reference how the devotees of Tirunelveli, otherwise Acharya Veli, he says heart of Sringeri, how the devotees of Tirunelveli have done so much for that. Especially the devotees of Kalidi. All this is captured in that essay very beautifully. That's historical. Therefore, we had to choose between options what to speak. So I didn't go into that. So his rediscovery of Kalidi is very important. And when Kalidi Kumbhabhishekam was performed in 1910, T.K. Balasubramaniam wanted to hand over the entire compilation of Shankara's works. And he went to Acharya and asked, how do I do this? Acharya said, you advertise. Let's see who is ready to give manuscripts. Manuscripts came from 9 sources, including one from Germany. Then the 33rd Acharya read through them and chose, this is the right script, print it. Even, see, Ramco publication has now done it again, recently, few years back. It's a great service. So, the entire works of Adi Shankara are in 20 volumes. T.K. Balasubramaniam started dispersing Srirangam and wanted to place it at the lotus feet of Acharyal at the time of Kaladi Kumbhabhishekam in 1910. He completed only 12 volumes, which were released. And Saachidananda Bharati says, I have discovered the place and installed the idol power, whereas T.K. Balasubramaniam has brought all his works which will stand the test of time. So his contribution is more. See how compassionate he is in appreciating the effort of a devotee. And T.K. Balasubramaniam wept, saying that, I thought of handing over all the 20, but I'm not able to do. It happened in 1910. He completed all the 20 works only in 1913. Whereas Saachidananda Bharati departed in 1912. So he couldn't hand over the rest of the 8. So he redid the 20 volumes and went to the 34th Acharyal in a Navaratri. During a Navaratri time, said 20 volumes are ready. Then Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal said, okay, stay in this Navaratri here. In his dream, the 33rd Acharyal appeared and said, why are you sad? You are sad because you think that I am not there. Don't feel so. I am very much there. And I am going to cite two instances how he was very much there in the Avichinna Guru Parampara. I am very much there. The Acharyal will reward you tomorrow. Please don't decline that honor. It is my anugraham that it is happening. Therefore, take it. This happens in a dream. So next day morning, Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal releases the 20 volumes and paid rich tributes to T.K. Balasubramaniam's efforts. He goes there and prays and says, this is the dream I had yesterday. For which Acharyal replied, my guru also came in my dream and said, I should honor you. And I will honor you with the title Guru Bhakta Shikamani. And he was given a Rudraksha Maharakanti by Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal and said, are you happy now? The message which the 33rd Acharya dropped in his dream is very important. What did he say? Do you think I am not there? I am very much there. How? Two instances I'll cite. When we say this Guru Parampara is Avichinna Guru Parampara, what do you mean by Avichinna? Unbroken lineage. What do you mean by that unbroken lineage? One lamp lights another lamp. And you look, we see jyotis in our lives. First we light one jyoti and then the other jyoti is lit. We come, take 5 steps away and do a prostration. Can you make a distinction between this jyoti and that jyoti? Unless otherwise you are the person who has lit it, you can possibly say, I lit the first jyoti 1 minute before and the second jyoti 1 minute later. That's the highest you can say. You won't see the difference. Avichinna means only that. No difference. Unbroken. Forms change, but spirit don't change. How? Give you 2 instances. This happened in the life history of Teji or Subramanya Sastri. After all, a great human being. The 33rd Acharyal, Sachidan Sivaraj Bhartigal, when he came to Sringeri, initiated him in Navakshari. He was not happy. After all, Tejur is what? He has virtually slept in the lap of Meenakshi. He has done Chandi Parayanam sitting at the lap of Meenakshi. He is so devoted. So, he was not happy. He thought Acharyal will take him Panchadasakshari, 15. He took only Navakshari, 9. Then Acharyal found it. So, you are unhappy? He said, yes, I am unhappy. Don't worry. I will do the same thing in my next form. That's the assurance. What do you mean by next form? 20 years after that, he goes to Sringeri. He meets Chandrasekhara Bharati Swamigal for the first time. Please come tomorrow. You wanted Panchadasakshari even in my previous form. I will give that tomorrow to you. Please come. What is most important is, Chandrasekhar Bharati Swamigal comes to the Peetam after the physical departure of Saachidananda Shivabhinars. They have not met each other as Peethadipatis. Saachidananda Bharati departs in March 1912, and he comes to the Peetam on 7th April 1912. They have not met each other physically. So there is no way he would have communicated, I have taken Navakshari for Tejur Subramani Sastri. No. And if you read that history, it records it this way. Next day morning he is invited. When Tejur goes, see, after all, he is such an evolved person. He is honored. Acharyal says, I am waiting for you, come. To whom will he say this? Takes him inside, locks the room. Tejur finds a young girl, beautifully dressed, trenched in jewelry, sparkling pearls, kannu koosaradu. He sees it. Then Acharyal says, sit down, and initiates him in Panchadadakshari, touches him, and he gets into trance. For 20 minutes, he lost. After 20 minutes, once he is awake, he didn't find that lady there, and the door still remained closed. He profusely wept at the lotus feet of Acharya and said, I made one mistake. On seeing this young lady as a human being, I mistook, why should a lady be here in a sannyasi's place? No room is closed, the lady is not there. It can't be anybody else other than Goddess Sharada. I made a mistake. Acharya says, human beings are bound to commit mistakes. Compassion. And clarified, any mantra in this Peetam, Acharya will be empowered to take it, initiate it on a Sishya. But Panchadasakshari, Sharadambal has to give her blessings. In your case, she was physically present. That's the difference. This is one instance. The second instance is, with that we'll close. The second instance is when a devotee goes and worships, then 34th Acharyal asks, are you Subramanyam? Then he says, yes, I am Subramanyam. Then he moves. Jnananda Bharati Swamigal, R. Krishna Swami here in his purvashrama, chases the devotee. He says, is your name Subramanyam? No. Are you coming from a place called Subramanyapuram? No. Then Acharyal inquired you, Subramanyam, you nodded your head as Subramanyam. Oh, no, that's different. His guru, the 33rd Acharyal, initiated me in Subramanyam mantram. So when Acharyal asked me Subramanyam, I said, yes, I have been initiated in Subramanyam mantram. That's all. Both Acharyals have not met in their lifetime. So, when Saachidananda Suvarasi Bharatigal says this to T.K. Balasubramanyam, do you think I am not there? I am very much there. This is the answer of this Ajivan. If you want to see Abhinava Vidyatirthar in Samahasanidhanam, you can see Abhinava Vidyatirthar. If you want to see Chandrasekhar Bharati Swami in him, you can see Chandrasekhar Bharati Swami. Whatever you want to see, you can see in him. Because he's not different. That's exactly the message which is being driven. It's 8 o'clock. I wanted to share that Videha Mukti of 4 Acharyals. We'll see whether I can do it tomorrow. Tomorrow we will exclusively deal with Jagadguru Srimad Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswamigal. It's very difficult to contain him in 1.5 hours, but I'll just give you the taste of it. But whenever you find the time, please buy those 3 volumes of Guru Kripa Vilasam. Read it line by line. It will take enormous time. It's not that you can go through it, because the dialogues he have had with 2 Sishyas, Kuppuswami Iyer and his son, Justice Chandrasekhar, who was the judge of the Honorable Supreme Court. Those dialogues, they are about 180 pages. The quintessence of Advaita just given us a pulp and a juice. So those 180 pages will take some months to read and reach. assimilation, vichara, that all, whenever we have destined, we'll do it. But don't miss these three volumes. Ensure that you pick it up and try to read it. So tomorrow we will meet 6 p.m. sharp again. And I thank once again Tathuloka, Ramachandran Mama, Sharla Mami, and Madam Basmati for supporting us in this, to do this lecture. May I devote and dedicate with utmost bhakti and reverence whatever has flown this 1.5 hours at the lotus feet of Mahasannidhanam Jagadguru Srimad Bharati I Mahaswamigal and Sannidhanam Jagadguru Srimad Vidushekara Bharati Mahaswamigal. Let's meet tomorrow. Thank you so much. Please.